Partiality. You know, God is not partial to one of his children over another child. On Judgment Day, we all get exactly what we have coming. No more, no less. And you know, not one of us will be able to say, well, God likes Johnny better than me, and that's the reason Johnny caught a break. It's not the way it's going to work. God is not a respecter of person. That means he shows no favoritism to his children. God is not a respecter of person, and we should not be respecter of persons either. We should not show partiality to others based on social status or financial status, financial standing. We should treat everyone equally and fairly. And you know, that only makes sense if you expect others to treat you equally and fairly. You have to reciprocate. Let's begin our study in the book of Genesis with one of the first examples of someone favoring one person over another. And as you might suspect, it's a young man favoring a young woman. Open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 29. I'm going to pick it up with verse 15. You see, Isaac has just instructed in chapter 28, Jacob to leave where they're at. Because why? Well, they were surrounded by Canaanites. And Isaac said, I don't want you taking a wife of the Canaanites. Go to your mother's family, and he's got daughters. You can take a wife there. And so while he was journeying there, he stopped to rest, and he used a rock, a stone for a pillow. You know the rest of that story. That became the stone of Schoon, Jacob's pillar, often called. And you know that God appeared to Jacob that night, and he looked up that ladder and he saw angels descending and ascending, back and forth, coming down to earth. And at the top of the ladder, he saw the Lord standing there, and he promised him, he said, I'm going to make your seed as numerous as the dust of the earth. And Jacob said, when he woke up, he said, boy, this is a special place. I'm going to call this Bethel, the house of God. Jacob journeyed on, and he met this young lady that he really liked a lot. Her name was Rachel. Let's pick it up. Chapter 29, verse 15. And Laban, this is Jacob's uncle on his mother's side, said unto Jacob, because thou art my brother, actually his nephew, we're related is what this is saying, shouldest thou therefore serve me for naught? I don't want you to work for me for nothing. Tell me, what shall thy wages be? And of course, later when the law was given, it would be unlawful for one of Israel to place another one of Israel in servitude, in bondage. Make a slave out of them, in other words. You could go into bondage, but only for a seven-year period. And then everyone was set free after 7 years, unless it was mutually agreeable upon the person who was bondage and the bond man for him to stay in service. And they had a procedure for that, verse 16. And Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah was tender-eyed. This doesn't mean that she had deep eyes. It means she had weak eyes, if you translate it properly. But Rachel was beautiful and well-favored. And Jacob and Rachel were already kissing cousins, if you back up and read verse 11. And Jacob loved Rachel and said, I will serve thee, this addressed to Laban, Rachel's father, 7 years for Rachel, thy younger daughter. Every sabbatical year, the seventh year, people went in that were in bondage were set free. And Laban said, it is better that I give her to thee than that I should give her to another man, abide with me. You've got a deal. We'll just make this arrangement, and after 7 years, I'll give you Rachel to wife. And Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed unto him but a few days. The boy was smitten, and the love he had to her, he was in love. Verse 21, and Jacob said unto Laban, give me my wife, for my days are fulfilled, that I may go in unto her. The 7 years are up. Now you keep your end of the bargain. And Laban gathered together all the men of the place and made a feast. No doubt the wine was flowing. And it came to pass in the evening that he, this is Laban, took Leah, his daughter, the oldest one, remember, and brought her to him, and he went unto her. The old switcheroo. And Laban gave unto his daughter Leah Zilpah, his maid for an handmaid, which was a customary at the time. And of course, Zilpah would become a concubine to Jacob as well. 25. And it came to pass that in the morning, the very next morning, behold, it was Leah. Jacob awoke from his sleep and realized he had the wrong chick. And he said to Laban, what is this thou hast done unto me? Did not I serve with thee for Rachel? Wherefore then hast thou beguiled me? You deceived me. Something not very nice for an uncle to do. And Laban said, it must not be done in our country. It must not be done in this place, in other words, to give the younger before the firstborn. You know, he didn't mention that when the agreement was first made, I'm sure is what Jacob was thinking. You know, after 7 years of hard labor is a heck of a time for you to bring this up. I think Laban probably realized that he had one daughter that was a little bit on the homely side, and he had one daughter that was beautiful. And he thought, you know, if I don't get rid of that homely one now, I may never get her out of the house. 27, fulfill her week. This means complete the 7 days of her wedding feast. This is Laban speaking to Jacob. And we will give thee this also for the service which thou shalt serve with me yet 7 other years. 7 years he worked for Rachel, and he ended up with Leah. And what does her dad say? He said, well, stick around and work another 7 years, and I'll give you your desire. I'm sure he's thinking, hey, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. And Jacob did so and fulfilled her week. He completed the 7 days of the wedding feast. And he gave him Rachel, his daughter, to wife also. And Laban gave to Rachel his daughter, Bilhah. Bilhah wasn't his daughter. His daughter was Rachel. That kind of reads funny there. His handmaid to be her maid. And again, Bilhah would become a concubine to Jacob as Zilpah. Was. What we have here are the mothers of the patriarchs of the 12 tribes of Israel being gathered together in one house with Jacob. Verse 30. And he went in also unto Rachel, and he loved also Rachel more than Leah. He favored Rachel more than Leah, and serve with him, that being Laban, yet 7 other years, 14 years, and he finally got what the original agreement was for. And when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, or loved less, we could maybe say, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. God interceded on behalf of Leah here. He realized that Jacob was showing favoritism to Leah. Verse 32, and Leah conceived and bare a son, and she called his name Reuben. Reuben, if you translate it, means see a son. For she said, surely the Lord hath looked upon my affliction. Now therefore my husband will love me for giving him the firstborn. 33, and she, Leah, conceived again and bare a son, and said, because the Lord hath heard that I was hated, he hath therefore given me this son also. And she called his name Simeon. Simeon means hearing. Verse 34, and she conceived again and bare a son, and said, now this time will my husband be joined unto me, because I have borne him three sons. Therefore was his name called Levi. Anyone want to guess what Levi means? Levi means joined. 35, and she conceived again and bare a son, and she said, now will I praise the Lord. Therefore she called the name his name Judah, and left bearing. She would have no more children for a while. Judah, if you translate it, means praise. So here we have the beginnings of the 12 tribes of Israel. Rachel, eventually's womb would be opened, and she would bear Joseph and Benjamin to Jacob. Zilpah, the handmaid to Leah, would bear him Gad and Asher. Bilhah, Dan, and Naphtali. Leah then would, her womb would once again be opened up, and she would have two more, Issachar and Zebulun. God forbids men from showing, let me say, parents better. I don't want to be gender specific. God forbids parents from showing favoritism to their children. Turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 21. And we just talked about one who did show favoritism to one of his children over the other, or at least his other children perceived as such. You remember Joseph, one of the 12? Jacob kind of favored him a little. He made him a real fancy coat of many colors. You remember that? And boy, then when Joseph had a dream about how great he was going to become and shared that with his brothers, oh, he really stoked the jealousy, and they went about planning on how they could get rid of him. But parents showing favoritism to children, one over the other, is not favorable in God's eyes. We're just going to pick up a few verses there in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 15. If a man have two wives, one beloved and another hated, well, that sounds like where we just came from, doesn't it? And they have borne him children, both the beloved and the hated. And if the firstborn son be hers that was hated, then it shall be, when he maketh his sons to inherit that which he hath, that he may not make the son of the beloved firstborn before the son of the hated, which is indeed the firstborn. The man cannot deny the firstborn rights just because he was the son of the wife that he loved less. Can't play favorites. 17, but he shall acknowledge the son of the hated for the firstborn by giving him a double portion, which was standard at that time, of all that he hath, for he is the beginning of his strength. In other words, his family being extended, the right of the firstborn is his. God does not show partiality to one of his children over another, as we opened with. Turn with me to Romans chapter 2 in the New Testament. Romans chapter 2, and we're going to pick it up with verse 1. And it reads, therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest. For wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. For thou that judgest dost the same things. You know, everyone falls short. We all sin. We all need forgiveness from our Heavenly Father, but none of us has the right to judge another. Because if we do judge another, we condemn ourselves to what? Because we do the same thing that those who that we're judging are doing, we condemn ourselves to being a hypocrite. And you know, God does not like those who claim to be holier than thou. Make a note of Isaiah chapter 65, verse 4 and 5. That's where God says, those who eat swine's flesh and those who are holier than thou are like smoke in my nose. Jesus said it well in the gospel. He said, you know, you go about to judge your brother and you see the little piece of sawdust that's in his eye, but you can't see the board that's in your own eye. And you know, that's one reason I'm glad my judge is above our Heavenly Father. You know, men make mistakes. Men show favoritism. Men are partial. God is not. He's entirely fair. We each get exactly what we have coming, and I'll take his judgment any day. Verse 2. But we are sure, or we know, that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things. God judges, God corrects. He's fair. He shows no partiality. Verse 3. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? Do you think because you judge someone else and you turn around and do the same thing, you're going to escape the judgment? No way. The great white throne judgment, Revelation chapter 20, when that comes about, there's not going to be anybody standing between you and your Heavenly Father. And the judgment will be fair. And again, that's the reason I'm glad he's the judge. 4. Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long suffering? That means patience. Not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. And you know what? The fact that he is long-suffering, our Father, is stated in, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. It states there that God is long-suffering, not willing that any of his children should perish, but they all come to repentance. That's what he wants. Will it happen? Probably not. Verse 5. But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, that means non-repentant heart, treasurest up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. Verse 6. Who will render to every man according to his deeds. We all reap what we sow. What you deserve is what we're going to get. Verse 7, to them who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. Boy, I want to be in that group, don't you? Eternal life, that sounds good. Is that for everyone, though? Verse 8, but unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath, verse 9, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first, or of Judah first, and also the Gentile, those not of Israel, Hellenist, for example. But glory, honor, and peace to every man that worketh good, to the Jew, Judah first, and also to the Gentile. Verse 11, for there is no respect of persons of God. Doesn't matter if you're of Judah or if you're a Hellenist, you're a Greek. You still get what you deserve on Judgment Day. God shows no partiality. Verse 12, For as many as have sinned without law, not knowing the law is what this means, such as the Hellenist, shall also perish without law. And as many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. That was the covenant of the Old Testament, the law. Verse 13, for not the hearers of the law are just or are right or righteous before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. James chapter 1, verse 22, we learn that the encouragement of James there is be not just hearers of the word, but doers. Because if you're just a hearer of the word of God and not a doer, and you think you have salvation, you're deceiving yourself. You got to walk the walk if you're going to talk the talk. Verse 14. For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, they're not under the covenant of the Old Testament, do by nature, just by their own second nature, the things contained in the law, these having not the law, are a law unto themselves. And you know, you've known people that never graced the door of a church in their life. But they're good people. They're honest, hardworking people. And it kind of makes you wonder what some churches are teaching people. Because it seems like the ones who grace the church door sometimes are the used car salesman that looking for a contact to sell a car. And that's the only reason he's going to church. But those that just by their own nature are good-hearted people. And not even trying to fulfill the law, just because they're good, they fulfill the law. Is what this is saying, verse 15, which show the work of the law written in their hearts. It's like the law was written on their mind even. Their conscience also bearing witness, and their thoughts, the mean, or between themselves, while accusing or else excusing one another. Verse 16, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. Revelation chapter 20, judgment day is coming, that great white throne judgment. You know, if you're promoted to a position of responsibility where you work, and workers report directly to you, as a supervisor, a boss, you should be treat your people equally and fairly. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. Most of you familiar with Ephesians 6. We're going to pick it up in verse 1, but the latter verses of that are where we learn about the gospel armor. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. That's what children should do, is obey their parents. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. It's the first commandment, what this is saying, and that first the commandment is Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. But that commandment, if you do it, comes with an assurance. Is what this is saying, a promise, that it may be well with thee and thou mayest live long on the earth. That's the promise of Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. If you don't honor your mother and father, you don't have a right to expect a long life on the earth. Verse 4, and ye fathers, on the other hand, you parents, I'm going to say, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. If you raise up a child in the word of God, they'll not soon depart for it. We learn in the Proverbs. Servants, this is not a slave, but anyone who works for someone else is what this is talking about. We're all servants. This is at the workplace. be obedient to them that are your masters, to your boss. Christians should be the best employees. Why? Because of this verse. We're taught to be the best worker that we can be. Whether that boss is a believer or a non-believer, he's paying you 8 hours of pay, you give him 8 hours of work. To them that are your masters according to the flesh, with fear or reverence and tremblings, means sincerity, in singleness of your heart or mind as unto Christ. Just as you would serve Christ when you're at work, you should serve your boss. Verse 6. Not with eye service, someone who needs to be watched continuously, as men pleasers, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, from your mind. Verse 7. With good will, doing service as to the Lord and not to men. Verse 8, knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free. What goes around comes around. If you treat people fairly and equally, you're going to be treated fairly and equally. If you're rotten to them, don't expect anything different from your father. Now, on the other hand, directed to the masters, to the bosses, verse 9. And ye masters, if you have supervisory responsibility, do the same things unto them, to the servants, forbearing or not threatening, knowing that your master also is in heaven, neither is there respect of persons with him. With our Heavenly Father, he doesn't show favoritism to one of his children over the other. We should not show favoritism to our brothers and sisters as well. If we do righteously, we will receive rewards on Judgment Day. If we choose to do the other route, we can expect punishment. Turn with me to Colossians chapter 3. Just over a couple books. Colossians chapter 3, we're going to pick it up with verse 14. Colossians 3:14. And above all these things, in other words, this is the most important, put on charity, that's to say love, which is the bond of perfectness. It's the glue that holds the many-membered body together, I like to think. Verse 15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. This means well-favored. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And you know, because his word is in us, we are rich. Revelation chapter 2, verse 9 and 10, Jesus is talking to the church of Smyrna. He says, you know, I know your poverty, but you're rich. Why? Because they had the truth. In all wisdom, teaching and admonishing, that means warning in some cases, one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Verse 17, and whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Verse 18, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. You are one flesh when you become man and wife. Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Verse 20, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1, where we just came from. Verse 21, fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. 22, servants, again, employees, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. Be the best worker that that employer has. And you know what? People start a job in a beginning level. But if you're the best and you work hard, I don't care if it's digging ditches, if you're the best ditch digger and the hardest working ditch digger that your boss has, you're not going to be digging ditches for long. You're going to be promoted. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord, not unto men. Hard to do at times, but if we do, we make the right decisions and not the wrong decision. 24, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ, and he owns everything. 25, but he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he hath done, and there is no respect of persons. No favoritism, you get exactly what you deserve. You know, if you show partiality one person over another, God looks upon it as a sin. In conclusion, turn with me over a couple more books to the book of James, James chapter 2. James chapter 2, verse 1, and it reads, "My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect to persons." Try to help everyone that wants to be helped. You know, there are some people, you couldn't help them if you really, really, really tried. Because, why? Because they don't want to be helped. Those, disregard. Don't waste your time on them, is what I say to that. Verse 2. "For if they're coming to your assembly," let's say this church, if a man comes into our church here, "a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel," I mean, woo, he's looking good, "and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment," one that's dressed to the nines and one that's looking pretty rough, kind of shabby looking, "and ye have respect," or ye show favoritism, partiality, "to him that weareth the goodly or gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place. Let me escort you over to the front row. Oh, and by the way, did I tell you where the coffee pot and the tithe box are? And say to the poor, on the other hand, stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool. Come over here and let me rest my feet on you." In other words, showing disrespect to the person. "Are ye not then partial in yourselves, in your own conceits, and are become judges of evil or wicked thoughts? Hearken, listen, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith?" The church of Smyrna, I know your poverty, but you are rich. "And heirs of the kingdom which he hath promised to them that love him." And you, some would treat them shamefully. "But ye have despised the poor," by telling them, "Stand over here." Don't even give them a chair to sit in. "Stand over here," or "Come over here and let me rest my feet upon you. Do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do not they blaspheme, speak evilly, that worthy name by the which ye are called?" They speak badly about Christians, is what this is saying. 8, "If ye fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well." And that means treating others fairly and equally. Again, you can't expect them to treat you fairly and equally unless you're willing to do that. Verse 9, but if ye have respect to persons, ye commit sin and are convinced or convicted of the law as transgressors, as violators. So God looks upon someone who shows favoritism as that is sin. So, and you know, it's difficult at times to treat others the same. And you know, there are instances, we started off with Jacob and him showing favor to Rachel. And of course, you have to be careful not to make it to where young men think that they have to treat all women or think on all women equally. That's not the way it works. Men are attracted to certain women. Some women they're not attracted to. So in friendships also, not necessarily a man and wife situation, but friendships, you're naturally drawn to some people. You naturally want to be around some people. Some people, you don't want to be around them so much because just the way that you feel about them. So, but as much as you can, be impartial. Our Heavenly Father is impartial. We should be impartial as well. Let's go to His throne. Yahweh, Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your written word, Father, the guidebook that shows us how to be happy in the flesh, Father. How to get by in this flesh life and the man who walks under the sun. Father, let everything that we do the remainder of this day be the honor and glory of Your name. We lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world. Father, watch over, guide, protect. We're always careful to give You the praise in Yeshua Jesus' precious name. Amen.
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, "Behold, I have foretold you all things." Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravett, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Who says there's the judgment when you go to heaven? What does it mean? Am I going to heaven, or what do I have to do to go to heaven? Well, John 3:16 tells us everything we need to know about gaining a ticket to heaven. It's called believing on Jesus Christ. There is a judgment after we die. Everyone will be judged by God at the great white throne judgment. And what will we be judged upon? Our works, and as it states in Revelation chapter 20. And you know, people have a tendency when they hear judgment to start shaking at the knees and cringing at the thought of judgment. That's because they're anticipating punishment. But judgment for some will be rewards. That's payday for those who are righteous children of God. So how do you get to heaven? You believe on Jesus. That doesn't mean you'll never sin again, so you want to be sure and repent of your sins, and repent of your sins often. That's the sure way to get to heaven. Jeff from Texas, is it all right in God's eyes to wear a necklace with a cross on it, or is it considered idolatry? I wear it because it keeps reminding me of the things Jesus went through for me. Well, as long as you don't worship that necklace, and I know you're talking about the cross and not the chain, but as long as you don't worship that necklace, there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. And many people do wear crosses, and it's probably the same reason that you do, to remind them of the awesome price that Jesus paid for us on the cross. Exodus chapter 20, verse 5, we have the third, I believe it is, commandment, don't bow down to graven images. That would be if you're worshiping that necklace, but if you're not, no problem. Greg from Virginia, I'm writing to tell you that since I have given my life to Christ, my life has a purpose now, and I watch your program every morning and have learned more about the Bible from you than my church. I want to say God bless you and your family, and thank you. And thank you for that witness, Greg. We get a lot of mail like that. We don't like to dwell on them and spend a great deal of time during this, the question and answer period, but occasionally it's good that people understand that this ministry is helping people, a lot of people. Evelyn in Arizona, there are so many Bibles out there. How do you know which one is the right one? I have a King James Version, and my husband, I guess that is, has a NIV version. We are hungry for God's word, but we want the one that's really God's and not a phony. We sure appreciate the time you take to explain God's word to us. Well, you're sure welcome. And we, Evelyn, we recommend the King James Version Bible. Why? Because it's keyed to the Strong's Concordance. You can take a Strong's Concordance and look up any word in the Bible, Old Testament, the Hebrew language or Chaldee, the New Testament, the Greek language, and through a numbering system, you can take that back to the original languages, which adds a lot of meaning to your studies. Any Bible is okay, but again, we recommend the King James Version Bible. That way you can check out what God's Word says, or if I say a word means something in the Hebrew or Greek, you have the capability to check out what I said, and it is true. Carlos from California, one question as to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, can I take this scripture and say that we made an arrangement with the living truth God to be born of woman? I'm looking forward for your answer on TV, Pastor Dennis. This is very crucial for my understanding. Plus, not too many brothers and sisters can comprehend that we existed before we were born of woman. That's one of the great mysteries, as it's called in the New Testament in several places, mysteries of God, is understanding that there are three earth and heaven ages, not three earths and three heavens, different locations, but different ages. The verse that you're referring to continues on, and he, being Jesus, also likewise himself took part of the same. And in other words, he was born in the flesh. Emmanuel in Isaiah chapter 7, we were to call Jesus, which means what? If you interpret it or translate it, means God with us. So just as he, Father, expected his children to be partakers of flesh and blood, he was willing to do the same also. And it goes on to say why he was willing to do so also. It was to defeat he who has the power of death, that is to say, the devil. Jesus defeated death when he paid the price on that cross, as it states in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, O death, where is thy sting? Grave, where is thy victory? Death does not have a sting. The grave does not have a victory. Al in Connecticut, can you please explain about Easter? some people celebrate Easter and some don't. Well, if you have a Webster's College Dictionary, 7th edition or earlier, look up the word Easter. You might be surprised. You're going to learn that it's a pagan spring festival. Nothing to do with Christianity. Then the reason it has to do with Christianity is because of a bad translation. Acts chapter 12, verse 4, the only place in God's word you find the word Easter. But if you have a Strong's Concordance, please take that and look up the word Easter as it pertains to Acts chapter 12, verse 4. You'll find that the actual word in the Greek is Pascha, which means Passover. And that's what we celebrate here at Shepherd's Chapel. Well, I've never heard of such a thing, Christians celebrating the Passover. Well, you haven't read 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 and 7. Jesus Christ became our Passover. It's his blood which causes the death angel to pass over us, just as the blood of the Passover lamb in the book of Exodus chapter 12 caused the death angel to pass over them. So Easter, a spring festival that celebrates fertility, the quick, like a bunny rabbit, very quick to reproduce, the egg being a symbol of fertility. So we celebrate Passover. Thank you very much. Lawana in North Carolina. What is the difference between a mortal soul and an immortal soul, as in looking at it in the present sight? Well, present sight, past sight, future sight, the difference between a mortal soul and an immortal soul is that mortal means liable to die. In other words, it's possible that that soul would still die. Well, you mean souls die? Yes, souls do die. It's called the second death of Revelation chapter 20. There's a first resurrection in Revelation 20 that God's election partake of. Everyone else is dead until the end of the 1,000 years, and they're spiritually dead. All right, so they have at that point mortal souls. Why? Because it's possible that they're going into the lake of fire, which is the second death. Immortal soul, again, are those, though, that death is not a possibility, as it states in Revelation chapter 20, verses 5 and 6, the elect who partake of the first resurrection, the second death has no power over them. That is the death of the soul. At that point, they have an immortal soul. Smyrna in Delaware, a good name. I've been watching Shepherd's Chapel for many years. I get more understanding from God's Word by studying with you every day. I'm glad you're enjoying studying. Your question, this bothers me a lot and would like to know what you think about this. A lot of pastors in most all churches put Rev before their name. Isn't Jesus Christ the only one to be reverenced? Thanks so much. Here at Shepherd's Chapel, we reverence God, not man. Man is not worthy to be revered, and evidently those who put reverend in the front of their name think people should revere them. All men fall short. Any man or woman of the cloth that tells you they're perfect and they're without sin, I'd question their ability to tell the truth. Joyce in Georgia, I was in an accident and had a brain injury. Now I take medicine for my short-term memory. I was wanting to know if God took that into consideration. Absolutely. God knows our abilities and he knows our disabilities. And, you know, he gives us responsibilities according to our abilities. Luke chapter 12, verse 48, The words of Jesus, unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall much be required. Pearl in Nevada, do you believe the dead can know anything about their family or see them when they're deceased? Well, no, I don't believe that the dead can see into our dimension any more than we can see into their dimension. Now, I do believe that there are special circumstances where God will allow someone who has passed away temporarily to see into this dimension. In fact, I know of cases where God has allowed one to visit this dimension. And it's when it happens is when someone is particularly having trouble with the death of a loved one, and God allows that loved one to visit them to let them know, it's all right. I'm still alive. I'm not dead. And again, until the second death, which is the death of the soul, which comes at the end of the millennium after the white throne judgment, no one is dead yet. And you know, yes, people die in the flesh. That's part of living. But they're alive with him still. No one is dead at this point. We have a God of the living, not a God of the dead. He despises death. Deidre from Louisiana, what day were all the races created on? And I'm sure you've heard of us talking here on the chapel about the six-day creation and the eighth-day creation. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and the following verses, man was created there. That's what we refer to as the sixth-day creation. And of course, one day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8 will document that. Then on the beginning of Genesis chapter 2, in chapter 2, I should say, you have the seventh day, the Sabbath, and God rested. Then he created Eth Ha'adam, I speak in the Hebrew tongue, the man Adam with the article, which is the seed line through which Jesus Christ would come. We refer to that creation as the eighth day creation. Lowe's in Washington. Did the Israelites ever stop at a city while they were wandering in the desert for those 30 years? Well, it was actually 40 years that they were wandering in the wilderness. And no, there were no cities in the desert. We're talking the wilderness means a desert. No cities. Demetrius in North Carolina. Please help me with these two questions. In the Old Testament, the practice of multiple wives. Well, at the time of David, for example, it was permissible for a man to have more than one wife. We do learn, however, in Deuteronomy chapter 17, that a king of Israel was not to multiply wives to himself. That means not an excessive number of wives. Solomon, the son of David, had a problem with that. I think he had something like 600 wives and 300 concubines. Today, on the other hand, we are, as Christians, to obey civil law. Civil law says you have one spouse, one wife, and that's what Christians should do. You follow with having servants, men and women servants. They're never called slaves as many today would call them. There was a place in the Bible where one of the servants was being beaten. If he was all right, everything was good. I don't understand your last part. I don't remember the rest of it. Okay, well, I don't know where you're talking about, but there were servants and they were called bond men and bond women in biblical times, ancient times. And God, you know, set up rules of how servants were to be treated. and he expected people to treat them as such. Dan, in there's nothing permissible in God's word about beating your servants is the point that I was trying to make. Dan in Missouri, pastor, while in war, is it murder to kill an enemy soldier? Of course not. And I know a lot of pacifists, peaceniks, if you will, try and put a guilt trip on our military personnel who have been in combat. And in a combat situation, it's either kill or be killed. And self-defense is a right in God's word. And you know, we should not be trying to put our troops who have been in combat on a guilt trip. We should be thanking them for protecting the rights and freedoms that we enjoy in this great nation. Murder is lie in wait, homicide, and different rules apply to it than killing. To kill in a war situation is not murder. Larry in Pennsylvania. In the beginning of Matthew, God told them to wait till Herod died before Joseph, Mary, and Jesus could come back. If Herod died and it was safe for them to come back, how come we hear about Herod in all the later books of the Bible? Because there were more than one Herod. There were four different Herods. It's kind of like Pharaoh. It's a title, not a name. All right, I'm out of time. I love you all a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying God's word in depth. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. Most important this, though, beloved, you stay in his word. Every day in Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus, Yeshua, our Messiah, is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645. 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
This has been a long time I've been promising a children's book. This is a book that will help a parent teach their child exactly what God's word states. Now, this was done by a very good friend and student of this chapel. We have given it, if you would, a binder whereby if there is a page that you feel is too far advanced for your children, then by all means you should remove that particular page. It is done in a material that is even washable, and it takes you step by step into instructing a child, what does God's word say? And I think you will find it extremely helpful. It is item number 4414.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say, welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. We're ready to get back in our Father's Word. Another topic today, Satan's bargains. You know, you really need to know his MO. That's to say his method of operation. Even in the garden itself, when he said to Eve, oh, go ahead and take of the tree.